without further ado, I'd like to welcome both Nas and Anthony to the stage for our keynote discussion and our award ceremony. Nas and my guys, what's going on?
What's going on? What's good?
Sir, how are you?
Man, I'm great. It's a great day for you guys because of one great special thing that's happening today, but we're going to get into that later. First, I want to give a proper introduction. So we have Nas. Nasir Jones is a multi-platinum Grammy Award-winning rapper, songwriter, actor, investor, and entrepreneur, having released 12 studio albums, including Grammy Award-winning album King's Disease. Nas is known as one of the greatest rappers of all time, with hits that include I Rule the World, I Am, Nas Is Like, I Can, and many more. He has co-starred in the motion picture film Belly, rest in peace DMX, and he's executive produced Netflix series The Get Down, which if you haven't seen it, you gotta see it. In addition to his successful entertainment career, Nas, in partnership with Anthony, has quietly invested in over 100 technology startups, which we'll get into a little bit later. He's also the co-founder of Massive Pill Records, founding partner of Queensbridge Ventures, owns clothing brand History, and he's a partner in the high-end chicken and waffle spot, Sweet Chip. We also have Anthony Saleh. He's the CEO of Imogen Entertainment Group. He oversees the careers of Alina Baraz, superstar rappers Future, Gunner, and of course, Nas. He's previously partnered with Troy Carter to be the executive vice president of Atom Factory, where he helped represent Nicki Minaj, Robin Thicke, Mary J. Blige, Lady Gaga. He's also a partner at Winderco, where he teamed up with Jeffrey Katzenberg on and others to invest in the next wave of digital media and startups. His portfolio includes over 150 companies, which we'll get into. And he's also been named as Forbes 30 Under 30, Billboard's Top 30 Under 30, and Billboard's Power 100, as well as win an Emmy for his work in the ESPN documentary Survival 1. So again, phenomenal backgrounds. Super excited to have you guys today, especially today. But before we get into the questions, I just want to say, Nas, congratulations on your first Grammy for King's Disease and for having Illmatic inducted into the Library of Congress as a poet, writer, and one of few Black artists to have this type of recognition. How does it feel?
Thanks. First, I want to say thank you for having us. It's great to be here. It feels great. It feels great. It feels like, honestly, like, it's like I'm a new, it's like my first album. King's Disease is like my first album. It's like starting all over again. It's kind of hard to explain. But in the Library of Congress, I mean, that blew me away, you know? It's like if the world blows up, you'll still find my album. Like, it's protected. And, you know, it's just a great year so far, considering all the craziness going on.
Yeah, no, for sure. The Library of Congress piece, the fact that is cemented in culture, it's crazy. Somebody told me they send it to Mars in case the world blows up. I don't know if that's actually true. I got to fact check that, but that means a lot, man. For people to better get to know you guys, I'm going to throw some random rapid-fire questions at you. I'll kick it off. In elementary school, I'll start with Nas and go to Anthony. In elementary school, Nas, what did you want to be when you grew up?
In elementary school, I wanted to be everything I saw probably on television. Bruce Lee, the Jackson 5, Captain America, you know, Peter Parker. You know, I had a wild imagination, so I also thought I wanted to be a fireman. Hey, I was a kid just dreaming. And, you know, I took the music, like, you know, like I was born for it.
Got you. So vivid imagination, renaissance kid, basically, in your head. Anthony, how about you?
Man, honestly, there was only one thing I ever wanted to do my whole life until I somehow slipped into music, and I wanted to be Stuart Scott. I wanted to work on ESPN. I was a massive sports fan. I mean, I still am. Like, you can't sit down with me for 5 minutes without arguing or debating something about sports. I even sometimes like contemplate, should I just like quit everything and just try to figure out and start from scratch how to get into sports? But yeah, my whole life my dream was to be on ESPN. Like, so I didn't quite get there, but you know, I got, you know, it's but I mean, I'm still very happy with my path, but that was my childhood dream growing up.
Well, you could, I mean, I don't think it's out of reach for you to get on ESPN a few times. So, you know, I'm just saying.
I'm gonna be honest though, like, I'm not a showman. Like, I can't go up there and do it for entertainment. I think I'd be too, like, get too mad. You know what I'm saying? Like, the way like Stephen A. Smith could just argue with people and then laugh at commercial breaks. Like, not when it comes to sports. I can't do that.
So if you had a superpower, Nas, what would it be?
If I had a superpower, oh man, I'd time travel.
Time travel. Anthony, how about you?
Fly.
Fly.
I just
Okay.
want to pop in, see the homies, pop back home. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's just so many amazing people around the world. So like, to just be able to go touch them real quick and come back would be amazing.
All right. Now this one is super random. And either one of you can chime in. So if soap hits the ground, is the soap clean or is the soap dirty or is the floor clean?
Soap's dirty.
Depends on, I mean, depends if it's solid soap or liquid soap to me. You know what I'm saying?
If this is in my shower, it's clean. If it's not in my shower, it's dirty.
All right, cool. All right, so those are the rapid fire questions, man. So for the throughout this conversation, how I want to approach it is I want to start from early in your career, pull from lyrics, you know, some of your songs, some deep cuts, and then dig into those and then understand what you were thinking about in your head personally. And then as you got later into your career, what was evolving and manifesting on the business side.
Okay.
Cool. All
Yeah.
right. So I'm gonna start with your 2004 album, Streets Disciple, Bridging the Gap with your pops. You say, and I quote, "I'm an artist from the start. Hip hop got in my heart. Graffiti on the wall could have ended in Spofford. Juvenile delinquent, but pops gave me the right type of tools to think with. Books to read, like X and stuff, because the school said the kids had dyslexia. None of them would like my style, read more books than the curriculum profile," end quote. Now, you've expressed how education is important to you, and you've educated so many through your pen. In that verse, though, you speak to some of the structural flaws with the traditional school systems, especially for Black children, and then the self-education that you embarked on at an early age. So I'm just curious, what gave you the courage in the eighth grade to say, "No, I'm doing this differently. I'm dropping out of this system, and I'm going to educate myself." How did you go about that self-education, and how did it evolve as you grew older?
Oh, I give all the credit to my parents, my mom, my pops, because of what books they had on the shelf. Like, I went from just looking at the books, just passing it by, to opening it, to look inside, see if they had pictures, to actually taking my time, you know, as I got older and know that, you know, reading some of the stuff that was on the shelf. And you know, they had these books, you know, that I didn't see in school. And they were more interested in the books in school. My education was at home. It started at home. I love the school system to an extent, but at home was the real lessons. You know, I would get comic books about Black history. I hated them because I'd be playing with my, you know, reading my Marvel DC joints, and my pops and some dude would come in and say, "Here's a box of comics about real people. These are not superheroes. These are real superheroes." That was not what me and my brother wanted to hear when we was that young. We hated it. But, you know, you realize later it was like it just was like a set off to what I would start to read as a teenager. And that took me on a journey into self-knowledge, learning about the great history of all people, but in particular Black people, and all the messages that I was starting to hear in rap music as a young kid, that helped too. So I was educated by my parents. So, and I had faith in what I was learning, that faith, that self-awareness, it instilled something in me that pushed me beyond what regular schools
Man, and it seemed like that stuck with you even as you moved out of the house, right? Because that education continued, and I know it, and we know it as fans, as listeners, because we would hear it come out through the songs you would put out.
Yeah, my bad. I was just venting.
Those two, you know what I'm saying?
I had to get it.
So Anthony, on a similar topic, you know, I know your path was a bit different in the sense that you majored in finance and mathematics in college. I heard stories of you in the studio working on your homework, as you was also working with Nas, but we'll get to that. But a lot of your management principles stem back to the values and morals you learned growing up. What are those management principles, and what individuals or experiences shape them as a young manager?
Yeah, I mean, I'll talk on the experiences first. They're both pretty personal, honestly. I think the first one I would say is I came from a big family. So, like, my mom is one of 17 kids. My mom is 13 women, 4 boys. My mom has 12 sisters. So I got 12 crazy, opinionated, loud, big, loving aunties who, like, or I literally have 13 moms. That's how I feel. So I grew up in such an environment where there was always love. Like, we didn't have much, you know what I'm saying? Like, I didn't get everything I wanted. And to be honest, like, you don't even realize you didn't have, like, Dave Chappelle said something real funny one time in a stand-up where he's like, when you live in the hood, you don't even realize how messed up it is because everyone around you is the same. But when you're like, when you're the dude who lives in the rich neighborhood, they ain't got no money, you feel it all. And so I never felt anything. Like, I had, like, the most amount of love ever. And it was always about togetherness and being together and all my cousins. And so, like, for that, like, to me, that was just instilled in me. And then the second thing, which is probably a bit more personal, but, you know, I want to be candid here, is that, you know, my father and brother, they passed away in a plane crash when I was in the eighth grade. And, you know, everybody has this moment in their life where they really hit rock bottom. Like, they taste it, they see it, they touch it. Like, every bit of them really like interacts with it. And then when you get to that point, man, it's like, number one, you learn to have empathy, and number two, you learn to have an abundance amount of patience because you just understand what it means to really lose something. And then and number three, like, It makes you fearless, you know. And I'm only afraid of things that are dangerous, and danger is something different than being scared. So, but yeah, those are the two things, and I just really instilled that in how I built relationships with my artists. And, you know, Nas is a great example of that. I mean, at this point, we're brothers. We're not even, it's like deeper than business, you know. So, yeah.
Man, first and foremost, condolences to the family, and then also that's a phenomenal perspective, and I think that comes across even when I first met you. I know it. I'm sure it came across when Nas first met you, which is the next question I'm going to get into. And so this is under the topic of both trust and partnership. Many people in the audience are working on startups now, or will go off to launch new ventures. You two found each other and were quite an interesting pair. Nas, you brought Anthony on as a manager when he was 21. And at that time, you were like around 33, 34. You were a vet in the game. So how did y'all connect? And what did you see in him that made you say, I'm putting my career in this 21-year-old's hands.
I knew a lot of people, but I never worked with someone so young. So I worked with some great ones. Anthony, you know when you meet somebody special, you know they just have that thing, you know. He was able to, the fact that he had the heart and the audacity to want to work with me, to want to, you know, I don't know at the time when we talked about working together, if it was going to be a manager position, but it quickly became that. Maybe that was what we talked about, and I don't remember the position, but I just knew that you had the audacity to want to jump into this game at the speed I was traveling on, and you were just, I knew it. You know, some things you just know, and he was everything. I like people who are, I think Anthony is not scared of danger. You scared of danger? You said you're scared of me. I don't think you are. And I think that's what stood out to me. You know, not danger like, you know, him being physically hurt, but like, you know, just diving in, being too young to, you know, he was ready. I knew he was ready. And I like that he knew he was ready.
Mm-hmm. So he was, sounds like fearless, you know? And Anthony, what was going on in your mind as you, like, you start working with Nas, right? At this point, like, Nas is, like, legendary. And you're, like, in college, in the studio with your books, doing your math homework. Like, what was, you know, what was going on in your head?
Yeah, before you start, Anthony, I like what you just said. He knows that story. He would be in the studios with me. We'd be in there at 3-4 in the morning. He's doing homework and stuff. And I'm like, what are you doing? He's like, yo, I got to go to school in the morning. I'm in college. I got the car downstairs. I'm driving from Midtown Manhattan. Where was you going?
Westchester
or something. And I'm like, yo, what is this? Is he okay? Can he drive? Did he get enough sleep? How's he going to work in school? Man, I take my hat off to you. Man.
Nah, to be honest, so Nas had this incredible dark blue and baby blue two-tone Maybach when I met him in New York. And I used to love running errands for him. Like, I would go to Barnes & Nobles and buy him books, or go to the liquor store and buy champagne. Because, like, I used to ride around in a Maybach by myself. Like, you understand, like, the first time I ate Mr. Chow, I was like, yo, what is it? Like, I didn't know these things existed. Like, I used to tell Nas all the time, like, I remember when the OJ chase happened, I asked my mom, like, yo, I'm from LA. I was like, where's Brentwood? I never even heard of Brentwood before. Like, it was like, so all these things were so new to me. But you know what, man? I looked at Nas and I was like, man, this is a really nice guy who seems like he wants to do better and he's kind. And I was like, I'm just not going to be afraid to tell him the truth. And every single person I spoke to around him, they were so tense around him and so, like, afraid to talk to him. And when I got to know him, I was like, this guy is an open book. You just have to, like, talk to him, not through him or around him. He's a smart guy. And I think the key to working with a guy like Nas is not to try to outsmart him. And I had no problem being cards on the table. It's how I was raised. So, like, when we had problems, it was all cards on the table and we figured it out. And I think him seeing me in that light, you know what I mean, on the battlefield, calling out plays, walking through everything, being like, all right, this does have a solid chance of not ending well, but this is why we should still do it. And us being so open about it all, I think that really, really helped build a bond in our relationship.
And your aunt, a little story. I didn't like touring. You know, I mean, I like shows. I didn't really love being away from home too long. So I wasn't in Europe for a long time. And Anthony was telling me about getting back into Europe and getting my thing going again out there. And I felt like I can go when I was ready. I wasn't really big on touring anyway. And he asked me, you know, what was the shows like the last time I played there? And to me, you know, I'm out there, it's fun, the crowds are good, and I for me, it looks like the place is packed. So I said, oh, yeah. He said, was you selling them out? I'm like, oh, yeah, everything was sold out. He was like, no, it wasn't. In this place, in the last time we went there, there was even less people because you're canceling shows. And I'm like, yo, but I'm canceling them like a month out. He's like, no. You got a bad reputation with the promoters, with agents, with everything. Things that I didn't see, I didn't take so serious. Like, just stuff like that, he changed the way I looked at touring. That's just one thing. He changed that I would, this is my name on the line. This is, like, if I say I'm going to be somewhere, you know what I mean? Do it. And then show me the way to look at taking this from these smaller venues to the arenas that I could have been playing. Yeah.
Man, that's remarkable. Like, so Anthony, because you're young at the time and you're basically like shifting the principles in which you guys and like Nas and the business around Nas is operating, like rebuilding those relationships. That's amazing. And actually,
Sorry to cut you off, Nick. To like 2000 and when we had that discussion about touring.
07, early 07, something like that.
Yeah, since then I'm a much better guy, you know, when it comes to all of that. I don't cancel nothing. So this is a long time ago, people. I've been
So I'm going to shift into the evolution of both Nas and Anthony together as businessmen. So music, I know, has a history of having very defined lines between business people and creators. Creators were largely asked to focus on their creations while the labels and business people reaped outsized profits from their work. I know this because I have a father who's a jazz musician and siblings who got burnt by the label system. Now, one can argue that hip-hop and rappers initiated the creator-slash-entrepreneur economy largely because in the 80s, there was no infrastructure to support hip-hop as an art form. Now, the lines between creatives have merged, resulting in this like term, at least we call here Stanford, which is smart creatives or like creative CEOs that are operating with small teams or just a manager and who are able to build substantial enterprises like you guys. Now, Nas, with your 2012 album, Life is Good, song No Introduction, you say, quote, hood forever, I just act like I'm civilized. What's really in my mind is organizing a billion blacks to take over JP and Morgan, Goldman Sachs, teach the world facts and give Saudi their oil back, end quote. That's a powerful statement and things that me and my boys talk about often. Now, you two have been working together for a few years now. My understanding is that you started to change your environment and immersing yourself with different circles of people. What clicked in your heads to make a change? Who were the people that you started to surround yourself with? And how did they influence what would subsequently manifest on the business side?
I'm going to tell you the first time that I really woke up was when we were dropping Nas's Untitled album. And I was sitting, this is like 2008, I'm sitting in Def Jam. And all I kept hearing about was Walmart, Target, Best Buy, Target, Walmart, Best Buy. And how they control how many CDs we sell. And I'm just like sitting there like, this makes no sense. And then we went on a tour in Europe. And when we were in Stockholm, Sweden, I had heard about Spotify. And so it launched and I had started doing my little research on it. And I was like, oh shit, like the music business, like, I don't think I was like, yo, this thing is moving really fast. And you know, it's hard to let go of a good old business model, right? Like hard to let go of that instant gratification of getting that $10 instead of like, I will say this, the music business, the biggest difference between now and 10, 15 years ago is the business finally realized pennies add up. Like these pennies add up to billions of dollars, right? But back then they didn't want to go there. So I just started kind of self-educating myself a bit on what was happening. I would have conversations with Nas like, yo, we need to like change this. And one of the first things I did was I went to go work with Troy Carter. And when Gaga really started blowing up, he was like dead focused. He used to say like, yo, we're creating all this private wealth for these public companies. Like, this don't work for us. So, like, you know, he started, like, reaching out to folks, and then I started reaching out to folks, and he started bringing me into deals and whatnot. And then one day I sent an email to a friend of mine. It was kind of a cold email, and asked him to forward it to Ben Horowitz. And actually the person who really encouraged me to really reach out to Ben was a guy named Neil Mehta from Green Oaks Capital. He was very instrumental in our story. Obviously our brothers Anand and Dee Murthy, Amin Mahajan, who ended up forwarding the email to Ben. These are guys who really were like, you guys should do this. So we reach out to Ben. Ben's like, come. And I'm sitting there like, yo, I don't know nothing about this guy. So we show up, and this was like early days of Horowitz, right? Nas had met him. Yeah. Nas had met him at a barbecue, I think through Steve Stout, right?
Yeah, Steve Stout introduced him. Steve Stout would set up these dinners, like a meeting of the minds. It would be like the founder of MTV here, Soledad O'Brien there, somebody who started that company. And Ben Horowitz here, we're talking about barbecue and hip hop.
Yeah. So we started just like spending time with Ben, and you know, I started picking his brain specifically on like, okay, if we do this, like, what's our pitch? And Ben identified three important things that like really, really shaped my point of view, which was, you know, number one, we understand people. And when you come from the music business, it's just a different level of needing to understand people, because you're dealing with them all, right? And have to understand culture. And then the third thing is consumers and how they think about things, how they interact with things from a global perspective. And guys who get to tour the world, and you know, we know what people in Australia are watching, eating, listening to. Like, that kind of data and information is super important. At the time, back then, I don't think the technology world understood what culture like really meant. And a lot of like the technological advances over the last 10 years, the biggest like roadblocks was mass adoption. Now, if you take two specific examples from our portfolio, you have Robinhood and Coinbase, right? 10 years ago, how many people were connecting their bank accounts to their phones? No, money and health and healthcare data were like the two last standing, like super sensitive, like kind of data sets that people were just like not willing to let go. And so we really took the approach of, we are gonna help these tech heavy businesses that need mass consumer adoption understand and unlock how to get there. And as we became more vocal about these things, like, it really changed, you know, it really helped open the eyes of folks. And so that was the aha moment for us. Mm-hmm. When we grasped that, we just started running.
Man, and that's the, I tell people all the time, you guys were early into the whole, like, let's integrate ourselves with technology and begin investing in these companies. You guys, before it became cool for entertainers and athletes, and so you guys were on it early and moved like fairly quietly with it up until recently. So now I'm curious. So going back to that line that you mentioned in no introduction, right? Like the opening track on the album. Like what was going on in your head?
A couple of things. I felt like we've been left out of corporate America in every way. And doesn't matter how educated you were, it doesn't matter what you were good at. It was just this wall, this glass ceiling for African Americans. And my thing was, you know, you go back to that lyric, Hood Forever. I just, you know, that's just going to be what it is, because the world is hood. You know, in every arena, it gets hood. And you have to stay dangerous. And that's first and foremost. I'm staying who I am, because who I am has been held back. But I'm taking that drive into the world that is the land, the world of opportunity, and changing the game. I'm bringing in more people that look like me. And then I got a little cocky with the dependent of other countries' energy at the end with the give Saudi the oil back. You know, it's like, you know, just cocky raps, you know what I mean? Like, we're going to use our own energy. We're going to keep it. America's going to keep it. Like, everybody can keep their stuff. We're going to step it up so good that the black man is coming to teach us how to use these solar panels. And, you know, it's just hip hop lyrics, you know, just speaking things into existence. That's what I like about rap. You can, it's straight from the mind into the world, and you speak things into existence sometimes. So that's what I was going for.
Man, solar panels was funny. We have our Frontier Tech panel later today is a peer of mine who's actually doing that in South Africa as a solar company. So that's crazy, man. So from 2012 to 2018, there was a gap in terms of you putting out projects, right? And during that period of time, you guys got busy. So on Nazir Bonjour, you say, quote, all this money we get in could be gone in a minute if we don't invest, we long-term effective, end quote. And so during that period, that's exactly what you guys were doing. By 2015, you had started Massive Peel Records. You published a children's book, I Can, became the partner in Sweet Chick. And by 2018...
Oh, shout out to the restaurant, Coke, too. C-O-C-E.
Okay.
That's new, though. Yeah.
All right. Okay. But by 2018, you two invested in over 100, 150 companies, including, but not limited to, Dropbox in 2008, Genius in 2012, get this, Coinbase in 2013. Today, Coinbase goes public. These guys were on it in 2013. I'm just, look at your top VCs in Silicon Valley and ask them if they were invested in Coinbase in 2013. You have Walker & Co. 2013, Ring 2014, SeatGeek 2014, Robinhood 2014, Pluto TV 14, Lyft 15, FanDuel House Party, Ease, Play VX, Dapper Labs 2018, which is going bananas with NBA Top Shot, and many. So, how much of the you paused and working on your albums and investing with strategic planning versus being opportunistic in these new environments that you're immersed in? And on the venture side, what helped you pick well, and how much of the support came from your network of mentors, like those at Entries and Horowitz?
AD1 pitch meetings, going from studios at whatever time I felt like to, you know, flying out and taking meetings way too early for me. But, you know, it made me, anything I get into, I'm going all the way.
Yeah. This is such an amazing question because, like, I don't think people realize the things. People used to think I was crazy. Like, I spent all my money to invest in technology companies. Even Nas used to look at me like, yo, like, but I knew, like, the music business is a cash business. We'll go on a tour in the summer and I'll make it back. You know what I mean? Like, that was my mentality. I was young. And, you know, Felicia Horowitz, Ben Horowitz's wife, told me, like, yo, to create generational wealth, you gotta risk it all. And, like, that was my mentality. That's where my head was at. And, you know, I kind of shielded Nas a little bit from that because obviously he has a family and he has real responsibilities. I didn't. So I was like, I'm going all the way. And we're either gonna look like geniuses or we're gonna look like idiots. But you know what? I'm gonna go down either way swinging and we're gonna get it somehow. And I remember Coinbase specifically. A good friend of ours, he was a doctor, his name was Vinod, would tell us, like, hey, like, in 2012, he had mentioned to us that he was buying Bitcoin at, like, $30 a coin, and started talking to us about it, and I started reading up on it, a couple of us, Nas and I started thinking through it, and the thing that really sparked my interest was I got super addicted to understanding M-Pesa, which was the digital digital currency program launched by a telco company in Kenya, which like really helped propel transactions in the market where like there's no true banking infrastructure or very fragmented banking infrastructure. And watching M-Pesa work in Kenya, this is like 2011, 12. I was like, wow, like if this is gonna work in Kenya, like crypto has a place in this world. Yeah. So I called Ben Horowitz. This was like end of 2012. And I go, hey man, I need you to tell me everything you know about Bitcoin. And I want to get Nas on the phone. And Ben starts dying laughing, like, how the hell did you get to this point? So we get on the phone with Ben and we're talking to him. He's just explaining to us all the different applications. Now, mind you, I mean, this thing has gone to another place since, right? So a lot of the storage value things that are holding now did not ring true back then. But yeah, so then that was like, that happened. So we started buying crypto, figuring out how to get into deals. And then one morning, I get a phone call from Ben Horowitz. And he goes, Anthony, the hottest deal in Silicon Valley is raising right now. Coinbase, they're raising their Series B. We're trying to close it. Like, I'm having a party with the founders tonight. If I send you and Nas a jet, will you guys come and hang out? We're trying to close the deal. And then I asked Nas. Nas was like, oh no, Nas was like, we're going. So like, Nas and I get our stuff together, cancel everything, go to the airport, jump on a jet, and we're talking. And the funniest thing, Felicia Horowitz actually reminded me of it this morning. She started laughing when we were talking about the story because she came and got us from the front of their house to walk us to the back to meet everybody. And she remembered Nas going, we're gonna close this deal. Like, and he was just like super pumped. And I'm gonna be real, like, I don't think we truly understood the magnitude of what we were walking into at the time.
We knew if it worked. We knew if it worked, though.
Yeah, we knew if it worked. We thought crypto was as big as the internet. However big you think the internet is, we thought crypto could be that big. So we met Fred and Brian. I mean, amazing dudes. I mean, they're different in a lot of ways. Fred's just much more like, what are we doing? And Brian's much more reserved and calculated. But amazing guys. We had like an amazing night with them. Chris Dixon was there. And you know, the Andreessen Horowitz team, it felt like we closed the deal together. And look, they're Andreessen Horowitz. I'm sure they probably didn't need us. It probably was a nice little like wrinkle to add to it, but we felt a part of it. And we've been, you know, family with the Coinbase team and the Andreessen team since. And it was an amazing time. And I remember that night, Ben put his arm around me and he goes, this story one day is gonna mean a lot. You'll see. And I was like, okay, I hope so. But yeah, man, that's how it went down. And here we are today.
Yeah, when you say the story's gonna mean like something one day, like that's today. You know, I've already started to see some of the articles that came out. So wow, honored to be able to speak to you guys today and have all of that manifest, man. That's amazing. So I'm interested to know, after deploying money through Queens Bridge for numerous years, Anthony, I know you joined, you're also working with Winterco as a venture partner. So how did that manifest and how does that fit in, and how are you guys thinking about investing in business ventures going forward?
Yeah, so Nas had a couple exits over the last couple years, and Queens Bridge has essentially transformed into a family office for the most part. So so I, you know, deals may come through Nas's side, or deals may come through my practice at Wonderco, and you know, we do everything together. And you know, the Wonderco team looks at Nas as like almost like a kind of like, you know, part of the family. So it was like we're a package deal. Wherever I go, Nas goes. Wherever Nas goes, I go. Like blood in, blood out, all the way through. That's never gonna change. Nobody, no institution, no anything. And like no Nas is a deal breaker for me for that forever. And so, you know, I got to meet folks who respected that about me and didn't look at it like a distraction. They looked at it as like, okay, this is important to him, so it's important to us. And shout out to, you know, Jeffrey Katzenberg and Sujay Jeswayan Daly. You know, they really, like, it. They created a platform where I could still do what I do and do it with my guy. And Nas has brought a ton of value to the platform as well. Like, a lot of deal flow comes through Nas. It's like, it's a fruitful relationship for everybody. But we're as active as we've ever been. And are super excited to do a lot more in the next, 10 years. We really believe, like, if you look at the GDP of technology, it's hovering around, global GDP, it's hovering around 10% of global GDP. So you got to think the next 10 years are going to be far bigger than the last 10. So, I mean, everyone talking about it's too late, it's this, it's that, it's not. And I encourage folks to continue to be curious. That's the main thing. Be curious. Because curiosity is truly what got us here.
For sure. That's facts. So shifting from the investments and the business ventures into culture shapers' roles going forward. We're gonna unpack some of this on the culture panels, on the culture panel at 2 p.m. with Ebro and some others. But I wanted to share a few facts. So, Anthony, you mentioned the notion of culture export, like culture being us being an exporter of culture. So one in three streams globally are hip hop or R&B, so black music. Yet most of the decision makers are not black. 70% of songs on TikTok are hip hop or R&B songs. And another fact in terms of capital outflow, studies say that the average lifespan of the dollar is approximately 28 days circulating within Asian communities, 19 days within Jewish communities, 17 days in white communities, and just 6 hours in the black communities. The Nas, on your latest project, King's Disease, 27 Summers, you say, black car, black bros, more black CEOs. How do you two think about the role that culture creators / influencers and shapers like yourself play in shifting the paradigm and addressing some of the inequity that exists either culturally with your art or through your business endeavors?
Well, go ahead, Nas.
Well, I was going to say, speaking things into existence, the rap, and you brought up a great point earlier about hip-hop bringing an entrepreneurial spirit into the business because they didn't believe in it. And we had to show and prove. And we know what we need to do. We know why the dollar doesn't last in the black community. It's by design. It's not just that we don't support each other enough, because there are some black businesses that's been around for decades. But, it sometimes doesn't reach the level it could reach. That's by design. So it's a constant fight. The record business started years ago. It's the same game going on. And we are putting our best foot forward with Massapill Records. Me winning a Grammy on my label, independent, Massapill, is me speaking it into existence, me embodying everything I talk about. And that can kind of show people. I mean, kids today, they kind of know. They're aware of where ownership is at, and they're aware that a shift needs to happen, and a shift will happen. I believe we're on to something now. I believe many of us are. We just have to, keep people aware that we have to share this wealth around. It has to be, some of us or more of us in there running the TikToks and owning the TikToks and stuff like that. It's cool for everybody to get their bread, but if it's our talent that's doing these numbers, then we should be behind the ownership as well. And I do it through my words. That's part of what I do it in, through my actions, through my business.
A couple things on that. Like, I want to be super clear about something. The music business is not an industry black people have an issue making money. Like, I just want to be like, if we're complaining, we're crying over our how much, not we don't have anything. Like, now there are some exceptions to that. There are artists in bad deals and all of that. But true corporate America, not the creative side, the problems there are, and you can't even compare it. And so, So I want to be super clear there. Like, although, like, I do think that there are executives in music who should be running companies and making more money and that, but you're talking about who's making $500,000 who should be making $750,000, not someone who's making, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's
there are more Black millionaires because of hip hop in the history of America.
Now, yeah, exactly. So I don't
know. Sure, but we want more.
Yeah, we do. And by the way, we deserve more, but this is definitely a bottom up problem, not a top down problem, right?
Right.
The other thing is, and to touch on the streams, let me tell you, man, the stream thing has always been there. The problem is hip hop's consumption was always in the black market. Mixtapes, LimeWire, Napster, all of the interaction with black music happened where you couldn't quantify that. There was no data to quantify.
Right.
The minute Apple and Spotify launched, they're like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Black music is the biggest genre in the world all of a sudden. And no, it always was. You know what I mean? And it, in a lot of ways, it gave everyone a front row seat to see that. I think the best thing that has come out of the last decade of our lives, and I had mentioned this to Nas a couple times, the amount of DMs, text messages, emails, calls from people like around the world who are like, yo, we bought crypto 7-8 years ago because you and Nas were talking about it. You changed our life. Yo, we did this. Y'all opened a Robinhood account and bought this. You changed our, hundreds of times, multiple times a week. Yo, that is like the greatest feeling ever. Like, it's like, there's nothing better than that. Like, knowing that, like, whoa, you took the leap with us. Because I remember me, I was even like, man, I wasn't even sure, but I, you know. just to feel like people have that much conviction in us,
right?
It's amazing. Like, it's one of the most humbling experiences and things that I've been through in my life.
Yeah,
put me on the street to talk to me about investments. It's not about the records as much as it used to be. You know, it's all about, yo, what's the next thing? Yo, Nas, tell me what's the next thing I should be looking at. Yeah,
man, that's crazy. And Anthony, you make a great point in terms of like, the music industry like helped create a ton of wealth for hip hop artists and black people. That being said, music industry is small in comparison to a ton of other markets. And you guys know that, right? And so for the longest time, it's just basically people consuming the culture, but not bringing the culture into where a lot of the wealth creation is. And being able to, like you said, change that paradigm or influence that paradigm through what you guys have done, I think is amazing. So this is the last question for me, then we're gonna go to a few like open Q&As. Looking forward, so 20 years from now, Nas, 20 years from now, when you look back, what do you hope to have accomplished and what impact would you have hoped to make on society?
I think I've done it already. I've done all of the things. But for the next 20 years, I have no idea. I'm learning as I go. I'm changing things as I get the opportunity to. I can't even put that in words. Because already I'm really grateful to people that may see me as an inspiration, because we need that. We need people like myself who come from where I come from. And to turn, like I said on my last album, A Hood Home for Murder, now doing Mergers, Queensbridge Partners, you know? I mean, that to me is the great give back, and for people to see it. And the next 20 years, that's a long time from now. I just hope I continue to inspire.
Man, so on that note, I'm going to, that's the end of the curated questions. We have a few questions from the audience. Yeah, do you want to bring up the first one? There we go. We Tamer. Tamer, you want to quickly introduce yourself and ask your question?
Yes, absolutely. Hi, my name is Tamer. Thanks so much for being here. I graduated from Stanford last year and I'm currently on the content strategy team at Netflix, hopefully valuing your favorite shows. And also I'm from Bed-Stuy. My mom is from Jamaica, Queens, so definitely feel that connection there. And I feel like being from New York and growing up in that environment, you have this crazy outsized confidence. And then you go into spaces where you don't look like everyone else and people are hesitant to trust that you have the knowledge that you do. So both of you have talked about going from music to venture, what you believed in about the industry, and what other people believed about you. But I'm curious, what is it that you believed about yourselves that allowed you to persevere when there was external negativity?
Take that first, bro.
I mean, I just, again, I'm like, I like history. So I digging into our history that wasn't taught in history books in school really gave me this whole confidence to know that my ancestors, what they did before there was America, just gave me all of everything I needed to know to walk into any arena. We did all this stuff thousands of years ago, so we could do it today. And, you know, don't let anybody make you feel like you don't belong. You know, no one is better than you. No one should. And sometimes we are the teachers, you know, and we have to come in and let them know, hey, I'm from where I'm from, but here's something you didn't know. Then I have an advantage. I can give you something that you didn't know about a demographic that you're not too familiar with. So we come in there not just with the education, but we also come in there with this experience, a world that they might need. They might need to know about.
I think for me, man, I learned a super valuable lesson from one of my uncles growing up, and he used to tell me, you never wake up in the morning with yesterday's problems. Like, you find peace before you go to bed, and you wake up the next morning ready to go. And me realizing I had the ability to do that made me feel like I was ready for anything, because I would just talk to friends who would just carry their issues for weeks, months, years. And I just found a way to, like, I found a release to that. And when I figured out I had that ability, it really made me feel like I could do anything.
Thanks for answering my question.
No problem. It's good to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Thanks, Tamer. Yeah, next I think we have Ty, right? Yeah. Okay, actually, hold on, I have to give a proper intro here. So this is the homie Golden, 24 karat Golden, for people in the audience, Anthony smiling. So if you guys don't know, Golden, he created the song Mood, which has been on top 10 on the top 10 Billboard charts, was number one for a long time. He has a question for you guys.
Yeah, man, by the way, me and him's actually supposed to meet up, man. I fuck with you, bro. Like, you're ambitious, and I respect that, man.
We'll make that happen, man.
Yeah,
I appreciate that. So obviously, much respect to legend that you are, Nas. I was really curious about, you know, what is the differences between your experience as a businessman and as an artist? How did those two different pieces of your life, you know, what did each one teach you about the other? And how do you balance both at the same time?
Man, being an artist and then being in the music business, the business is trying to take you out. It's trying to snuff out your artistry all the time, because all people care about is numbers. And you have to watch yourself, because everyone wants a piece of what you create. And that can turn you into more of a businessman than you are artists. And that balance is, look, nothing is easy. That is what I learned, is nothing comes easy. So what you have to do is, you have to have a team. For me, it's a team. It's my guy right there. It's Anthony and all my guys who come in and could lighten that load on the business side for me so that I could deal with that when I'm ready to deal with it and I can be an artist full time. For me, being an artist is the most important thing. You about to say something?
I gotta say one thing for you, bro, because this is one thing Nas does that, like, people think it's like, what? That's not a big deal, but it's true. Nas never gets in the way. Mm. He knows, like, all right, you got that. Let me just step to the side here. He never, since I've known him, he has never gotten in the way, ever, not one time. And let me tell you, artists get in the way of themselves more than any professional in anything. Like, it's the creator that always, he always steps to the side, like, nope. And
but that's because I trust my team.
Yeah, that is a God-given skill.
Yeah, I know what my team is doing. I know what's going on. And if you don't have that team in place, then you wind up doing every job. And that's what that, and you got to do that until it works out. You know what I mean? Until there's a balance there. But I think you already know. Mm-hmm. Just for even asking that question, you already know.
Yeah. Man, I was excited to have Godin come on, boys, because when I first met him, before everything popped for him, when he was a freshman at USC, he sat down and he said, I have this vision. I want to be an artist, like focus on my artistry for the first 10 years. Then I want to start to get into venture investing in technology. Then he was like, then I want to go into politics. And at 18 years old, I was like, I've sat down with a ton of different artists, and that was impressive to me. So I was excited when he was like, yeah, I want to join and I want to ask Nas a question. So, Golden, man, appreciate you for joining and hopping on.
Hey, thank you for bringing me on, Nick, and I appreciate your guys' time. Hopefully we'll link up soon.
All right, bro. Cool, man.
Thanks, y'all. Have a great day. Peace.
You too.
Our last question is from Ty Garrett. He's calling in from Atlanta. There we go. What's up, hey. Ty?
My name is Ty. I graduated from the GSB last June, so I'm a part of the OG pandemic class.
That's so good.
I wanted to say, you know, thank y'all both for y'all's existence. Like, Nas, your storytelling always reminded me of the power of dreaming and hard work. You know, from If I Ruled the World, One Mic, I Can, like, the messages are palatable. So, like, thank you for being you know, Peter Parker and the Jackson 5. And then, Anthony, your story was the juice I didn't even know I needed today, so I really appreciate you getting here. If I keep with that superhero theme, you know, Robin turned into Bruce Wayne. So, you know, congratulations on everything that's happening in your life. So, like, on to my question, at the GSB, we have this saying that feedback is a gift. And, you know, you two are at the top of your game, Nas. You're one of the most influential artists of all time, so I'm sure you get feedback from everybody and their cousin on what you should be doing, what your lyrics should be, should not be, your album titles, political stances, like all that, right? So I'm curious, like, y'all two, given that y'all are going to receive feedback from, like, so many different directions, how do you find the signal and the noise, like, determine what feedback will actually help you take yourself to, like, the next level so you can rap shit, like, you know, used to run the block, now I'm corporate?
I mean, that's easy. It's Nas and I being completely different, but also having like the same kind of foundational morals and values. And it's, you know, in a lot of ways, I remember Damian Marley and Nas used to always say this to each other. It's like iron sharpening iron, right? And I think Nas and I keep each other in check in that way. So like if something happens, he may have a pulse on like what he thinks. And then I may have a pulse on what I think. And then we'll talk through it and come to a place where, you know, we get to, you know, like a middle ground where we're comfortable with something. And I think it's really the two of us just checking each other. Like, if I think he's like kind of off the handle on something, I'll be like, yo, really be like, yo, nah. And then if he thinks I'm wilding out, he'll be like, yo, Ant, you're wilding. Like, you know, it's that easy. You know, like when you share so many battle scars with somebody, like just the pitch of their voice will get you to stop. You know what I'm saying? Like, cause you've been in it with them. So I think like, you know, for me, and I really feel like I could speak for Nas on this one. Like, it's really just the two of us staying connected that way and having that kind of like that relationship.
Yeah, Anthony asked me not to call him my manager a while ago. He says, stop calling me a manager, man. And because he feels like we're brothers and I don't know. He just feels like how he feels, but I still direct everybody to him as my manager. And we just have that kind of closeness outside of business. It's more about caring about each other's well-being as friends. And we want the same things. And we, you know, Anthony, when I met him, he wasn't stained by the game. You know, he was young and he wasn't stained and he never got stained. I knew it was stuff that would just brush right off of him. When it came to getting dirty, he was down to get dirty, but I knew he was built for it. And that was important for me, you know, because a lot of people I run across want to do things, but, you know, you have to be really, you have to see it from just not just being down with me. It's just like, you have to see it for yourself. I saw that he saw it for himself. He already knew his journey. He knew what he wanted for himself, and I liked it. I like that he knew. I like that he was after it. And I want to be a part of his team, as well as him want to be part of mine. And to this day, he hasn't changed. It's like just the other day, he called me with so much, he's hype about doing new deals. Like, I would hate to wake up and realize, yo, a year went by, 2 years went by, my guy, there's no steam no more. Like, I think something's wrong. I think something, you know, it's like, he's like, wakes up without even me. I could just had a thought last night. He'll wake up and had the same thoughts. And then we build from there. So it's like, I love that friendship. We have to say, it doesn't matter his age, doesn't matter how young he is. People are people. And some of us just have that thing. And we're not scared to make mistakes. We're not scared of losses. And we're going to take a swing at it. Yes. At the end of the day, we're just going to take a swing.
And one last thing is, I think, to end it on this one is, you know, I have no fear of being fired because I know my bond with him is different. So my ability to be honest is so much easier. And Nas knows I'm not going nowhere. So his ability to be honest is so much easier. And so that, like, that when you're looking at each other at that eye, like you can get through almost anything. And that's how we like block out the noise or assess the noise and figure out what should we be listening to? What should we not be listening to? So it really starts with him and I and how we're connected.
Or, hey, I appreciate y'all for answering that, man. That's beautiful.
Thank you.
Thanks, Todd, for tuning in. Now, the last part of this discussion, I want to take a moment on behalf of Stanford's Black Business Student Association, like to share and award you guys with the Innovators Award, which we give out to people that have taken a novel approach to their field. I think how you guys have done that both in the music industry and then also with regards to how you've approached tech investing warrants us presenting you guys with that award. If you were here, I would give it to you. If it's not already at the office, it's in the mail. But there's a few people that want to congratulate you. Yeah, can you cue me up? Man, y'all's over there doing everything.
I'm scared.
Nas and Anthony, congratulations. I'll never say that.
But we have to.
Yeah, that was the first time I was there. I was the first time Black entrepreneur. You guys are the first people to not only give me capital, but the support that we needed to make Walker Company successful. You guys are the epitome of what it means to celebrate the culture, right? And my Black folks' influence on that culture. You know it takes capital. You know it takes support. You know it takes loyalty. And for that, I'm forever grateful. You saw me at my earliest stages to the latest, and it's been consistency throughout. That authenticity got me to the other side. So this is so well deserved, man. I want to celebrate your wins, right?
When I heard that, this year's award was going to Anthony and Nas, I was so excited because they're my guys. I'm proud to know you both. I'm so excited to see how far you've come as investors and getting this well-deserved award. So many awards for you. First the Grammy, and now this. This one is Ultra Black. Raiders Oakland hat. Love you both.
Man.
Guys. Yo, let me tell you something, man. The first time Tristan Walker pitched us, we were the first person he ever pitched Walker & Co. He was so nervous, and me and Nas were looking at him like, why are you nervous? You're a fucking superstar. Like, I was like, I remember being like, yo, Tristan, we're in no matter what. Pitch us. And, man, I mean, that guy has become one of our, like, a good friend of Nas and myself. You know what I'm saying? Like, wow. And then, I mean, Ben, I already talked about him. His words can't describe, like, you know, the friendship. And, you know, funny story about Ben is specifically with me. All we talk about is sports and rap. We don't even talk about technology. It's like, well, I'm talking about
football. And good yak.
Oh, yeah, good cognac, too. But, man, that was amazing. Thank you so much for that.
Thank you. Thank you, Ben. Thank you, Tristan. Thank you, man.
Nah, man, for sure. The best part of getting those videos when I hit them was when I got Ben's back and I saw that he had on Versace slides with socks on and sweatpants, and I was like, that thing. And then his last line with Ultra Black, I was like, oh man, he's been following the culture for a long time.
Ben is the truth. He goes back with hip hop, man. When we talk about Red Alert cassette tapes he was having flying in the 80s, man. Like, yeah, he's the truth.
Man. Well, again, I know we're a few minutes over, everybody. Nas and Anthony, thank you so much for joining. Congratulations. You guys will have the awards soon. This is a great day for you guys. I know in the chat, they were talking about, as we're talking Coinbase, the price, like, I'm not looking at it, but it's been jumping up. So congratulations on everything you've accomplished. Man, hopefully I can catch up with you guys in person soon. I know Stanford is honored to have you guys join us.
Thank you, Stanford. Appreciate y'all.
All right. Thank you, everybody. We have our next panel is Run the Town, and then we have a few others. So see you guys across those.